After our pleasant stay in Lima, we had decided to continue our journey to see the mountains near the city of Huaraz. So we hopped on a night bus operated by Cruz del Sur from the Javier Prado station. The bus was quite fancy, so the 8-hour bus ride was a piece of cake as we slept most of the way. The city of Huaraz is located 420 kilometers north of Lima and is one of the biggest towns in the Andes, with a population of over 120,000 people. The city is known as a gateway to all sorts of mountain adventures. It has an elevation of approximately 3,050 meters above sea level, which might cause altitude sickness to unlucky visitors. So our plan was to take it really easy for a couple of days. We stayed in Vaca House Bed and Breakfast, which turned out to be a very pleasant place to stay with a great location in the city center. A private room was 60 soles, about 16 euros per night, including a small breakfast. As our first impression, we were both amazed by this little city. It felt really different from Lima. As we arrived after the high season, there seemed to be so much fewer other travelers, but the city was buzzing with local people. It felt safe to walk around. Already on the first day, we both had a headache and shortness of breath from the altitude. But for me, it became even worse in the upcoming days. On the third day, I woke up with a fever, so we headed up to see a doctor at the San Pablo clinic. The next couple of hours I spent in an intravenous therapy, taking both some painkillers and more oxygen-enriched air. When I was feeling a bit better, we got out of the clinic. But then I got an allergic reaction to some of the painkillers and almost passed out on the street. We had to return quickly to the clinic.
Yhteisellä seikkailulla.
And so I spent the rest of the day in all sorts of tests and treatments. As it turned out, I had gotten a salmonella infection, which was probably causing the fever. For the next 5 days, I had to lay low and eat antibiotics, while Riikka was helping me to recover. This wasn't quite the start we had planned for our time in Huaraz, but as we know, also misfortunes are a natural part of adventures. At least I had some time to edit the video from Lima. So perhaps you can imagine how good it felt to finally be able to start our acclimatization hikes in the mountains. First up, we booked a normal tourist tour to visit Laguna Paron, which is the largest lake in the nearby mountain range, Cordillera Blanca. Here's the day in a nutshell. We left in the morning, had a quick stop in Huaraz for some tasty snacks, then drove up a sketchy mountain road up to 4,200 meters. We joined the crowds and walked up to the viewpoint. Despite this being a very popular thing to do, we were completely blown away by the beautiful view of the 3.7 kilometer long lake filled with turquoise water, surrounded by multiple mountains. We took a lot of photographs, went to dip our fingers in the water, and watched while other tourists were kayaking.
Guayra, vamos, Guayra!
Ne appaat joutuu paimentaa meitä turisteja, kun jotain lampaita täällä. Kaikki huutelee vähän, että hei nyt pitäisi lähteä, nyt pitäisi lähteä. Ja ei kun pitää ottaa vielä pari selfietä.
After a couple of hours, we got back to the bus and drove back to Huaraz, enjoying the fascinating views from the bus window. We wrapped up the day with our first papas rellenas. The next morning, we again woke up early to catch a bus to another famous location, Laguna 69, Lake 69 is located in the Huascarán National Park, which is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. The lake lies at 4,600 meters altitude, so it takes some real effort to be able to see it. The national park greeted us with spectacular views already during the bus ride. Here, let us show you what it looked like. The hike itself started from Cebolla Pampa campground, and our guide told us that we have 6 hours in total to complete the trek. First 3 hours going up, and then 1 hour at the lake, and then 2 hours to come back to the bus. The first 40 minutes were easy. We started slowly ascending a wonderful valley. On the way, we saw the highest mountain in Peru, Huascarán, which reaches 6,768 meters in altitude. It didn't feel too difficult at first, but as it turned out, the last kilometer of the uphill was quite a challenge, especially for me as I was still feeling a bit weak after the hospital episode. Yet, we moved upward step by step and enjoyed the views. Finally, at the top, we joined a bunch of other visitors at the lake itself.
Ei hitto mikä ryömää, mutta täällä ollaan.
Niin ollaan. Mutta lounastauko. Ja sit takas alamäkeen.
Best.
The lake is stunning. But personally, I was even more excited about the snow-capped mountains next to it. The way back to the beginning was obviously easier, but we can't recommend enough to bring or rent proper walking poles, and if you have any knee issues, to wear some proper knee braces.
Pieni tilannepäivitys täältä. Kohta alkaa sataa, hullu sadepilvi tulossa. Matkaa vielä 45 minuuttia. Vuoret näkyy, vesi näkyy, joki näkyy. Ei ole hirveä kokoita.
No niin.
All in all, the Laguna 60 Inuave was well worth both the time and the money. The cost was 80 soles per person, including the national park fee, so around 20 euros. Probably the best single day hike we have ever done. Now, as you probably can guess from the title of this video, this was just the warm-up. Our friend from Finland, who had been in Peru as an exchange student, had warmly recommended the Huayhuash trek. So what is Huayhuash? It's a mountain range, located a 4-hour ride from Huaraz. It's considered one of the world's best hiking routes. There are many ways you can approach it. You can go for smaller 4-to-5-day hikes, or go all in and complete the whole circuit in 8-to-12 days, depending on your desired speed and route. It's possible to go there on your own, but as our friend recommended, we decided to find an organized hike with a professional guide. After some googling and visiting the offices of multiple tour operators in Huaraz, we decided to book a private 10-day tour, meaning 9 days of hiking and one rest day, from Varma Ecotours Peru. It would have been significantly cheaper to find a group tour instead, but at that time, we couldn't find any groups going for the 10-day version. We paid almost $2,300 in total for two, excluding the tips. Next up, we'll show you some examples and highlights from the Aventura.
Mikäs meininki?
Pakataan tavarat Huayhuash -maailmukselle, joka kestää 10 päivää.
Hirveä sekamelska.
The first morning of the trek, we woke up at 4 a.m. and hopped in a car, which eventually took us to the location where we started our trek.
Nyt ollaan lähdössä, Riikka, Huayhuashin 10 päivän seikkailulle. Tässä justiinsa saavuttiin tänne, missä on lähtöpaikka. Ja
paljon aaseja.
Paljon aaseja. Ja sitten yksi koira ja hevonen. Ei voi muuta sanoa kuin, että erittäin innolla odotamme seuraavaa 9 yötä täällä. luonnon helmassa vuoristossa näin korkealla lailla koskaan oltu. Toivotaan, että ei tule minkään näköisiä ongelmia. Jep. Mutta nyt
ensimmäiset pisarat tuli kosmoille.
Heti alkoi sataa. Mut nyt mennään. Matka jatkuu.
It's difficult to summarize such a 10-day mind-boggling experience, but let's try to describe a somewhat normal day of the trek. We woke up around 5 to 6 a.m. in our tent, got a cup of hot cocoa tea from our guide, then changed into hiking gear and packed our bags. The mountains were especially beautiful to watch during the sunrise. Here's, by the way, a picture of Yerupaja, the second highest mountain in Peru. According to our guide, its name originally was Yerupaj, back in the days of the Inca, and it meant the first light of the morning. A delicious breakfast was served in the kitchen tent, from where we also got our water bottles filled with boiled water, safe for drinking. Together with our guide Mitchell, we started walking between 6 to 7 a.m. and usually pushed upward straight from the camp. During the day, we only carried day bags. The rest of the gear was carried by the donkeys. So for example, my camera backpack had a weight of approximately 10 kilos, including 3 liters of water, a rain jacket, snacks, some random stuff, and the camera gear. After the first 1 or 2 hours of walking, we took a proper break for snacks.
These are the tres lagunas, so 3 lakes. The first and the third one are almost like, how do you say, super blue, because of the minerals that are coming down from the mountains. The hike up here took like 3 hours from our camp, 3 or 4. The last sprint was quite rough, but otherwise, as you can see, definitely worth it. It's gonna be an awesome day still, and it has been already.
We continued walking at a good speed until lunch, which we ate either on the go, or if the day's distance was shorter, at the camp. The highest amount of altitude we climbed in one day was 1,250 meters, which happened on day 7, but usually it was half of that or a bit less. When arriving to our camp, our arriero, Ronald, had always set it up, so it was a luxurious feeling upon arrival to just dive inside the tent for a nap after lunch.
Reijumäki.
Every day, we also had some afternoon tea accompanied by some snacks like churros, tequeños, or popcorn. Then a couple of hours of rest, or occasionally we found an icy lake to take a dip in.
Terve! Nyt on testissä tämmönen paikallinen jacuzzi, eli puhutaan vuoristojärvestä, missä lämpötila on mitä on, mutta eihän se meille suomalaisille missään tunnu, joten let's mennä. Let's do it! Ja
ihan pitu kylmää, ui saat!
Mut siistii.
Pirun siistii.
We gathered for dinner around 6 p.m., including a small information session regarding the next day. It became dark soon after dinner, so we could watch the sky lit with stars while brushing our teeth. We had no trouble sleeping despite some minus degrees, as the sleeping bags were warm. During the days of hiking, it was way easier to take both long and small breaks for photography because we had booked a private tour. We thoroughly enjoyed every single route, despite the fact that sometimes the walking hours felt long and challenging. The views were just breathtaking all the time as we climbed up to a new valley every day. We also encountered all sorts of animals on the way. For example, we saw donkeys, horses, sheep, cows, alpacas, vizcachas, all sorts of birds, including also the largest bird in the world, the Andean condor, which can live up to 70 years. While we witnessed well more than 10 condors in Huayhuash, like many other species, they are also vulnerable and facing habitat loss. They make their nests in the mountains above 5,000 meters. And of course, we saw a lot of dogs. Actually, there are quite many dogs living on the hiking trail, so there seemed to be always a new perro del día as our trusted hiking companion. One day, we even found a dog inside the entrance of our tent, giving birth to small puppies. By the way, the name Huayhuash has nothing to do with the question of washing. It actually comes from a small predatory animal's name in Quechua language. In Finnish, the animal is called pitkähäntäkärppä, which there used to be a lot near the mountains, when more people were still living in the area and farming small prey like guinea pigs. Unfortunately, we didn't see any Huayhuash. The highest peaks we climbed were called San Antonio at 5,100 meters and Santa Rosa at 5,200 meters. Let's take a moment to embrace the views. When it comes to organizing, we were really happy with our tour operator, the guide and the arriero. Our guide Mitchell is also an excellent cook, so we got to enjoy many moments of interesting stories and great food, even in candlelight in the evenings. Looking forward, it looks like the Huayhuash trek is gaining more and more popularity. On one hand, it's an important business for many, both people living in Huaraz and also in the mountain range itself, as the locals collect payments from the tour operators at each campsite, based on the number of tourists. On the other hand, we could see the impact of tourism already on many of the campsites, where some people had dumped their trash. Perhaps it could make sense at some point to limit the amount of daily or weekly visitors per location, and force more strict rules and better incentives against littering. All in all, this was a real aventura. Definitely the best trek we have ever done. These 10 days spent in the mountains will stay in our memories forever, especially as there are no real mountains in Finland. So we need to be extremely grateful for this opportunity we had. After the hike, we spent a couple of more days in Huaraz and then continued our journey forward. Thanks for watching.